Let's just lift our hands to the Lord. Yes, Father God, we desire for you to pour your Spirit out. Pour your Spirit out upon each and every one of us, upon the circumstances that are trying to conflict us and harm us. Father, pour your Spirit out upon our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, upon our neighborhoods, our neighbors, our region we live in, Father, this nation, this world. Pour your Spirit out. Thank you, Father God. You are the solution, Lord Jesus. And you use us to be that solution, to carry it out. So, Father God, we just render ourselves to you, Lord. Father God, we render ourselves to you and say, use us, Lord God. This first day of this new week, Father God, this new month that's before us, Lord. Use us the way you desire, the way you wish, Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus, thank you, Father. And Father, we thank you for your blood that covers us. It surrounds us, protects us. It forgives us, Lord. It forgives us, Lord. As we have forgiven others, it forgives us, Lord. And thank you, Father God, it heals us, Lord. Your precious blood heals us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God. Yes, Father God. Anyone who's in the sound of my voice, Lord, I pray that your healing touch would be upon them because of your precious blood. Thank you, Lord God. Your blood hasn't faded, nor is it dulled, nor is it lost any iota, inch, millimeter. It has not lost power in any way, shape, or form. But it's still is doing a great and mighty job in each and every one of us, Lord. And we receive that precious blood. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give them all of our praise. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Even those at home, come on, let's give him praise. He's worthy. He's so worthy of our praise. He's so worthy. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. So blessed to see you in the house of the Lord. So blessed to see you. And those who are online with us, God bless you, each and every one. You may be seated. God bless you. God bless you. God is so good. I've got like little like echo going on with my microphone here. But thank you, Lord Jesus. So, anyway, I just want to say good morning to everybody. God bless you. I love you. You see, the sanctuary looks, those of you who are in the sanctuary, you see it looks a little different. We've done a little rearranging of the furniture here. So we're so blessed to be able to do that. But thank you, Lord God.
Thank you, Lord God. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Yeah, and we're going to do some more rearranging.
We're going to do more, yeah.
We're going to do something with the carpeting and
yes.
A few more. How many believe that God's house should look the best?
Yes, it should. Yep, you're right.
Amen.
You're right.
Hey, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling blessed and healed. I'm feeling blessed and healed. Thank you for praying for me. I feel so much better. So much better.
We missed you last Sunday. You know that.
I missed you guys too.
But
I did.
Those that tuned in got to see you.
Yes.
On Wednesday night.
Yes, they did.
Good.
They did. That was awesome. So you know what? We want to take this time now because here we are. This is the first Sunday in the month of February. Do you believe it? Woo! Already 1 month down. We're already in the second month of 2024. My. So let's pray for the month of February. Let's pray for all the birthdays and anniversaries that are going to be taking place this month. And let's just believe God for great and mighty things. Amen? So let's just bow our heads. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for this beautiful month that you've blessed us with, Lord. Father, you said that every month you would do something new, something fresh. So, Father God, we receive that newness and that freshness for each and every one of us, Lord. And we ask, Father God, that you would touch every birthday, every anniversary for your glory and for your honor, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, may a harvest of blessings unfold upon each and every one, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus. And all those who greet said a big amen.
Amen.
Amen. Happy birthday. Happy anniversary. If that's you, happy birthday and happy anniversary. God bless you. God bless you. That's awesome. That is awesome. And also February holds Valentine's Day. So we're so excited about that. I love Valentine's Day. I've got hearts all over the kitchen and all that fun stuff. I love it. So also February is Black History Month. So that's really special. So God bless. God bless. So as many of you know, our little Chelsea Marie was born on Monday, January 29th at 1:56 in the morning, weighing in at 7 pounds, 2 ounces, 21 inches long. Hallelujah! Last week, while we were all in service, while you guys were in service, I was at home healing up. So that's when Janelle went to the hospital, and that's when things started to rock and roll. Yeah. So right after midnight is when pretty much when Chelsea really came into this world.
Yeah, okay. So you were not here. You were home catching a healing.
Catching my healing.
You engaged with us online.
I did.
Okay. I know you did. So I'm saying to these dear people here, those engaging online, I'm saying, you know, because her due date was Valentine's Day.
Valentine's Day.
And I said, you know, but who knows? God's perfect timing. And then she went to the doctor. She had the ultrasound. The doctor said, yeah, you have a big baby, 8-pound baby. You may want to give birth soon. But
God. And toward the end of your term is when the baby starts to really gain more weight.
Yeah.
So we said, boy, 8 pounds.
And she's still a couple weeks away.
Yeah.
You know, so I said last Sunday morning right here at about this time.
Yes.
Yeah, at about this time. I said she could give birth today, tomorrow, next week. The following week, mm-hmm. God knows.
Yep.
Little did I know, guys, little did I know that as I was sharing what I'm sharing right now, she was on her way to the hospital 1 week ago today at this time. So yeah. God's timing is always perfect.
It is.
God's timing is always perfect.
It is.
And she was not 8 pounds. She was 7 pounds, like you said.
7 pounds, 2 ounces.
2 ounces. So mm-hmm. I guess the sonogram, whatever they use,
how do they really know? I don't know.
Ultrasound, yeah. Ultrasound.
I think they do their best.
They do their best, but you know what? Hey, Janelle's grateful that she has a healthy baby.
Amen.
But she's blessed that it's not as big as the doctors thought it would be.
Yes.
Especially when you have, you know, a vaginal birth.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, what would you like to do? Would you like to show? How many want to see some pictures?
See some pictures.
Yeah. Now, many of you who are on Facebook, cute. Many of you on Facebook, you got to see some already. How many got to see some pictures on Facebook?
Yes. Did you? Oh.
Okay. How many would like to see them again?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll let you take it. Go ahead. We have a few.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. Let's see.
Here
she is, the little peanut.
She was just about an hour.
Yeah.
Maybe an hour old.
Yeah, there she is.
An hour young at that time. Welcome, Chelsea Marie.
Yep.
And how do we get Marie? Pastor Joni.
Because that's my middle name. Yep.
And it's Mark's.
Mark's mom's middle name.
Middle name. Yeah.
Her name is, I guess, Judith Marie. We call her Judy, but Judith Marie, and I'm really Joan Marie.
Yeah. So. And Mark's dad is James.
James.
And I'm James.
Right.
So it's interesting.
Yep.
You know, creates
they
no,
included the,
creates no
the
conflicts.
Grandparents. Isn't that beautiful?
Creates no conflicts when they name the child the middle name.
That's right.
Right.
That's right.
Make everybody happy.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so she was just about an hour old, would you think?
Yeah.
And she's got like that dark hair.
Her hair is so dark. She
and
has so much of it.
Word on the street is she looks like somebody. That's word.
You.
Huh?
That she looks like you.
That's what everyone's saying?
That's what they're saying. That's a word on the street.
Boy, I hope she looks more like you than me and more like a mother. You guys are prettier than I am.
Cute. Okay, next picture.
Those chubby cheeks. So man.
She's so brand new there. You can see she's still puffy.
If my dad were here, he'd want to.
Yeah.
He'd want to take those cheeks. How many like to pinch baby's cheeks? You like to pinch baby's cheeks? Do you? What is it about a baby's cheeks that you just want to pinch, right?
Charlie, I still.
What is it?
They're so cute.
They're so cute, right? Just like you. You're so cute.
That's right.
Anyway, I just want to pinch those cheeks. Okay.
Next picture. Let's see.
Oh, look at that thick. Well, she has thick hair. thick hair and not like me. Just thick hair.
Thick, straight hair.
Thick, dark hair.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the next picture. And there's Charlie. He's like, he wants to hold her, but he doesn't. But he wants to, but he doesn't.
But look at that smile on his face.
He gave her his truck. He gave her his truck later on. He put his fire truck, little toy fire truck, on Janelle's shoulder. Oh, so cute. He's like so smitten by her.
Yeah, and we didn't show this next. We have another picture we didn't show, but you know, now he's into so many different words. So everything's high five, high five, high five.
Yep.
So Chelsea, as you can see, her arm is lifted up. That's what babies do. So he thought my grandson, who's going to be three next month, he thought that Chelsea wanted a high five. So was it yesterday he said?
Yeah.
So he said, Gigi, high five.
High five.
Papa, high five.
High five.
Mommy, high five.
Grandma, high five.
He said, Chelsea, high five. You know, it was so good. It was so much fun. Talk about Charlie now. His latest words yesterday were what?
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. So he lifts his hands. He lifts his hands. Praise the Lord.
He does. And once in a while you'll get an oh dear. I'll say, oh dear.
Or he goes like this.
Wait a second.
Yeah.
You can tell we're having fun, right?
So it's been an adjustment. You know, those of you that have had children and more than one, you know, it's an adjustment to the older one.
Yeah.
So it was very interesting when Janelle and Mark came home from the hospital that they wanted to first spend a little time with Charlie first.
Right.
You know, and they wanted to give him gifts and then have him introduced to his sister. Mm-hmm. And then Chelsea had a gift for him.
Yes.
You know, and they had gifts for each other. So he got a truck. He loves cars and trucks, this kid.
He does.
And he wanted to share the truck.
And he loves car washes.
He loves the car wash.
He loves to wash his cars.
In the sink.
In the sink. Yeah. However, he likes to wash his car wash.
So he wanted to give Chelsea his truck to share, to play.
And then he said to her, too, play cars? Like he said to her, like, come on, let's go play cars.
Praise the Lord. Everybody, let's do it. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
There you go. Out of the mouth of babes.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right.
Okay.
Do we have any more pictures?
Two more.
Oh, two more. Oh.
Oh.
It's Gigi holding Chelsea.
You look a little happy there.
Just a little. She's so sweet. She's so sweet. I love all those sounds.
And I'm not sure. I think we may have one more picture.
Let's see. The twins, maybe. Picture of the twins. There we go, the twins. They're identical. It's amazing. It's really amazing. Cute.
So thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord, for our granddaughter.
Lord.
We thank you for our baby Chelsea, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord, that we call her blessed.
Blessed.
That she will be used for your glory.
Amen.
Serving you all the days of her life. And thank you, Lord, for a healthy birth. And Lord, we pray now for all of our children.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, those in the womb and those outside the womb. We pray blessings over all of our children, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Regardless of their age, we speak blessings over them, protection over them. Lord, may they encounter you afresh, I pray, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You know, one of the things that I pray for at night before I go to bed, I pray for a lot of things. You and I pray for a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things I pray for when I go to bed at night, one of the biggest things I pray for is that my children would have fresh encounters with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, fresh encounters with the Lord. You know, it's interesting how many times when they're younger, they have an encounter with the Lord. And then for some, it's like they don't have any more encounters or it's years in between. But one thing I pray for you, I pray that you have fresh encounters with the Lord. That's what I pray.
Mm-hmm.
And when Janelle was in the hospital, this is so touching. Because as you know, I've had fresh encounters with the Holy Spirit. When I was just 4 and 5 years old, going into my 5th birthday, I had an encounter with the Lord in the hospital room when I was dealing with nephritis. And I had a fresh encounter with the Holy Spirit when he came into my room. And when Janelle was in the hospital, she had such a fresh encounter with the Holy Spirit. And she said, "Dad, you remember that song we used to sing at the Benny Hinn Crusades about the Holy Spirit?" I said, "Well, which one, honey?" And she started singing, "Holy Spirit, thou art welcomed in this place." And she started to cry.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, "Dad, during the night, I had a fresh encounter with the Holy Spirit."
Thank you, Father.
And I kept singing, "Holy Spirit, thou art welcomed in this place." Let's just lift a hand toward heaven. Father, we pray for fresh encounters. Fresh encounters.
Yes.
Lord, when we go to the store, we want fresh bread. When we go to the store, Lord, we want fresh milk.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, we want fresh encounters with you. We want our children to be visited by you on a regular basis.
Lord.
We want, Lord, even our babies, Lord, while they're sleeping, encountering you in their dreams. But, Father, we pray for fresh encounters upon our lives every day, Lord. Lord, they don't have to be as drastic as the Apostle Paul being thrown from his horse. But, Lord, if they're just gentle encounters of your love, of your peace and joy, we receive them even now, Lord, that we are open to them, wanting them, desiring them, and expecting them.
Yes.
And we thank you for fresh encounters, Lord, with you. That keep us strong and stronger and resilient. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Give God praise. Amen.
Lord.
A to the man. Yes, 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 yes. Is that Audia right there?
Yes.
Oh, would you please stand up, Audia? Please, would you give her a big God bless you? Welcome back.
That's right.
She's had surgery, and we've had a few of our moms out,
mm-hmm.
and God bless you. Welcome back home.
Amen.
And Nancy, she'll be with us soon. She's engaging with us online even now.
Yes.
She's engaging with us
online even now.
And we love you, Nancy, as well, and all of you. Each and every one of you. And Mama Boehner, we love her so much.
We
and
do.
Mama Boehner had a birthday.
She did on Friday.
She had a birthday on Friday. So we speak blessings over Mama
Amen.
Boehner.
Yes.
And
Lord.
Her birthday in the name of Jesus.
From head to toe.
Medea, is that you,
Thank
Medea?
You.
Yeah,
yes.
You tell Mama we said happy birthday.
Yes, please.
All right.
Mm.
And Grandma Vella, would you come on up right here, please? Come on, please. Would you please come on? Okay, you got the cane. You go slow. That's okay. That's okay. You go. Look how beautiful you look. Look how beautiful you look. Are you okay standing for a minute?
Okay.
Look at that beautiful outfit. Tomorrow is her birthday.
Amazing.
Tomorrow she turns, believe it or not, you ready for this?
You ready?
58. 58. Now take those two numbers. Take those two numbers and switch them. And what do you have?
85.
Do you believe it? It's hard to believe.
It is. It's the Lord.
85.
Oh, it's the
Lord. To the glory of the Lord.
Wow.
Founding member of this church. Founding member. And I've known her even before we started this church. And we call her blessed in the mighty name of Jesus. And she asked me one day, she said, because we talk, we're friends. You know, it's amazing our relationship. I'm your spiritual father.
And son.
And son.
And a friend.
And a friend.
And a closer friend that I will trust him always with my life, both of them. And like I trust him, I trust all of you, and I love you. Love you because I think such a love.
Well, we speak blessings over you in the name of Jesus, and you look so beautiful. Yes. And she asked me once, she said, how long are you going to stay the senior pastor? How long are you going to be here? I said, Grandma, only God knows. God knows. I said, but I'll tell you this. So long as you're here, I'm going to be here.
Right.
Yeah, so Joe's going to help you back, okay? Yes, he will.
Okay. I love you. Mary showed it to me last night.
Oh, Mary showed you?
Okay. Yes, I love
you. And congratulations, because you're a grandma again.
Again.
With Chelsea.
I have how many great-grandchildren already this year?
Great.
About 4 or 5 already. So I lost count already.
No, but total.
Oh, my God, I think so. What, 20-something, Papa?
20-something great-grandchildren. Marina, how many do you think great-grandchildren she has about? You lost count after 25? Well, we love you, Grandma. And we speak blessings. And I know you don't need help going back. I know. But Joe's going to be there anyway. Give her a big God bless you.
Thank you, Lord. Wednesday night, we meet Facebook Live only at 7 o'clock is when Facebook Live begins. And God is doing some great things. The youth and young adults via Zoom at 7:20 with Pastor Eddie and Miss Kayleen.
Yes.
And God is doing great things in our young adults and our youth. And I just want to encourage you, our youth and young adults, you know, we all have the DNA of the Lord within us, right? And that DNA speaks to dry bones living again. That DNA speaks to the glory of God is flowing through our veins. That DNA speaks to many things that this world needs. And our youth and young adults carry that same DNA. Yes. So when we pray for our youth and young adults, we're not praying just for them, but we're praying for that generation and the generation after that. So
you
we just spoke
right.
about grandkids, great-grandkids. If we're still around, our great-great-grandkids. Nevertheless, we're praying for our kids, and our kids, providing the Lord tarries. Amen. So don't let a moment go by that you don't pray for the youth and young adults, because they've got a lot within them to give to this world.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. And how's Grandma Lucy doing? She's doing better. She's doing better.
Please give her our love.
Joe,
please.
How's your mama doing?
Both are doing well. My mom is
good. Well, we speak blessings over all the mamas of the church.
Mamas of the church.
And you know, Tuesday, talk about the younger and the older. We have a birthday on Tuesday as well.
We do.
Who's that?
My Leah. Malina.
She got the card in the mail last night.
Did she? They're in brown envelopes now.
Oh, good.
Now, you know, I know you got a little tripped up on her
name. Yeah, because for
she
sure.
has a nickname.
Yeah, for sure you call her Mila, right? Okay.
Right. But her real name is?
Melina.
So, yeah.
So pretty.
And if anybody else has a birthday, God bless you.
Yes.
We prayed for all the February birthdays and anniversaries.
We did.
If we missed you, we didn't miss you because we prayed blessings over you.
That's right.
In the name of the Lord Jesus. How many want to hear some real terrible news? Come on.
No.
Well, you didn't give any response, so I guess maybe that means some of you do. So I'll ask one more time. How many want to hear some bad testimonies?
No.
Of course not. How many want to hear some good testimonies?
Yes.
How many want to hear some wonderful praise reports?
Yes.
Ready? Thank you, Lord, for an unexpected $5,000 bonus. Whoa. Thank you, Lord. Thankful to God.
Wait, can you say the first one again?
Thank you, Lord, for an unexpected $5,000 bonus.
Wow. Somebody say, I'll take that. That's what Dick Mills would say, right?
That's right.
That's what he taught us to say. Hey, guess what? I'll take that. I'm sure you would, too.
Thankful to God, after an arduous semester, I got straight A's.
Ooh, wow. Wow.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Straight A's. I don't think I've ever in school gotten an A. I don't know if I ever did.
I got straight A's in art. I got straight A's in gym.
So, yeah. I got A's in...
study class.
I got A's in gym. I did. But other than that, I just got by the skin of my teeth. How about what?
A in lunch. I got A in lunch.
Yeah, A in lunch. Yeah, A in lunch. I got an A in lunch. Yeah. There we go. Talking about food again. Oh, man. I got an A in lunch is right.
I like that.
Yeah. And
that's cute.
That is cute. That is cute. But it's amazing, you know, because I was always so sports-oriented and minded
right. That
all I wanted to do is play sports, and I didn't care much for education. I did not care much for education. But plus, I missed school. You know, when you're in the hospital for almost 2 years, you know, you have some catching up to do. So every summer, when everybody looks forward to summer vacation, not me, because I had to go to
summer school.
Oh, you guys know about that, huh? I had to go to summer school every year just to play catch-up, just to play catch-up.
Wow.
And it's amazing. But then when the Lord said, I want you in Bible college, everything changed.
Mm.
Everything changed. And I graduated with honors as the valedictorian of Bible college.
Wow. All things are possible.
Now, guys, don't get too excited about me, because we had a lot of dummies in my class. I'm just joking. I'm only saying that because, to tell you, I'm not as smart as I look. Okay, but I really did. By the grace of God, I did graduate
awesome.
Number one in my class.
That's awesome.
That's grace.
I love that.
That's grace. That wasn't me. Mm-hmm. And they weren't dummies. They were smarter than me.
Mm.
And just that by God's grace, I think.
Yeah.
I applied really hard.
Mm.
Made up for a lot of lost years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Anyway, you got some more testimonies?
I do.
Is that it? How
I
many
do.
More do you have?
Two.
They don't want to hear it.
No, they do. They do. Thank you, Lord, for a change in title at work to the glory of God. May it bring me further success in my career. Yeah. Amen. Yes.
Wow.
Yes, let it be, Lord. Let it be, Father God. And may there be many more changes in the title.
The title. So, okay. So, Chief Garcia, you started, when you started in DuPage, you started as what? What was your title? Deputy.
Deputy.
Okay. And then from deputy, you went to? Sergeant. And from sergeant? To lieutenant. Lieutenant? Chief. And that's where you are now. Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
Isn't that amazing?
Amen.
And it's not just the title. It's not just the title.
Right.
You know, we said Wednesday night on Facebook Live, we said Wednesday night, Paul said, I'm an apostle. And he said, but I'm the least of the apostles.
Mm.
So it's not just so much the title, but it's who's behind the title.
Mm.
It's what represents that title. When I see Mark Garcia and I say Chief Garcia, I speak of who he represents.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't just say chief. Mm-hmm. You know, when you call me apostle, you're not just saying that. You understand the authority behind that.
Mm-hmm.
And I when you call somebody a prophet, you understand the authority. You know, when you call somebody a father or a daddy, you understand what that is. So, but look at where he started and look at where he's now. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And yes, those are titles, but he carries more than a title. He carries a personification and a character and integrity.
Amen.
That earned him that title.
Amen.
So
amen.
That last testimony means that last testimony that you just read
mm-hmm.
says a lot.
Amen. It yes. sure does. Sure okay. does. And then the last one is, my husband is ministering at work, and a man by the name of Angel came to salvation. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah for the greatest miracle, salvation. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. May Angel know you and experience you all the days of his life, we pray in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
Eight to the men.
Love you, church. God bless you. God
bless
you.
Let's thank the Lord for all these praise reports. Yes. Thank the Lord. Yes. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Lord God. We'll praise his wonderful name. We praise his wonderful name. Well, we thank the Lord, as Pastor Joni prayed, we thank the Lord for a new month. We thank the Lord for a new month. And the word says, every month I'll do something fresh. Every month I'll do something new. And I tell you, January was a wonderful month for Encounter Church. It was a wonderful month when you look at all the good things that the Lord has done. And to me, the greatest part of January for me, greatest part of January was being in Mexico. No. I make joke. Hey, I'm not going to kid you. That was a good time. I ain't going to lie. That was a good time. I looked today at my phone. It's 85 and sunny. 85 and sunny. Then I looked at Florida. I looked at southern Florida, 60 degrees and raining. I said to myself, I don't know. Maybe we need to change courses here and start going to Mexico and Puerto Rico. And because then I looked at the weather in Puerto Rico, I said, man, that's where I want to be in the wintertime for a little bit. But all kidding aside, the way this year has started in the spiritual realm with this word that God's given us on resilience, the first Sunday of the month, the way you guys just ate up the word of the Lord. And I see resilience all over you. So we thank the Lord for a wonderful, tremendous month of January. And we thank the Lord for an incredible month of February. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. But on the flip side, with the month of January, we had some trying times with the weather. Did you not? Were you here for it?
Yes.
I mean, were you in Illinois for it?
Yes.
I mean, some crazy cold weather. Wow, crazy cold weather. And snow and ice. And here at Pastor Joni and I are in Mexico, frankly, we're feeling bad. You know, some people say, ha-ha, we're on vacation. Oh, what's the weather over there? You know, a lot of times people do that, but they're teasing. You know, sometimes people do it and they're serious. No, but we really felt bad for you guys. We did. And so January was a trying month in many ways. Some people couldn't get out of their house. Some people couldn't go to work. Some people were not able to make it to church. Well, it also affected the finances of our church. And we, in the month of January, did not meet budget. We came close, but we did not meet budget, which means we have to take money out of an emergency account to make things continue to go on for the next month. But thank God for whatever we have in the emergency fund. Thank God that it's there. Now, listen to me very carefully, because there are people watching online as well who may not be a part of this church or who may not be very friendly with this church. I don't know. You listen to me. I don't know of too many churches that have been around for more than 30 years. And God always has supplied and will supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. And I know Encounter Church is a generous church. And I know, and I'm saying this because God gave me this word for you for the new year. This is a resilient church. So I'm not worrying. I'm not fretting. And I'll just tell the amounts. Thank God they weren't a lot. But as Joe mentioned on Friday, on Wednesday, that it was 2,500 or something like that, or 2,562. Something like that. Yeah, because you know the numbers better than I do. Well, guys, we fell short. Listen to this. We fell short $969.08. $969.08. Now, we never want to fall short, but I know churches have fallen short of $10,000 and $20,000 and $30,000. So that's not bad. But our God is more than enough. Our God is more than enough. One of the situations that we've noticed for the month of January, and those of you watching online who are part of the hybrid church, we know you're faithful. So please, first and foremost, we know you're faithful. Now, not everybody who engages online contributes. We've mentioned that a couple weeks ago on a Wednesday night. I really spoke about that, if you recall. And that's understandable. That's understandable. When you watch Christian TV, you don't always give to all the ministries, right? Yeah, that's understandable. However, it would be nice for those that regularly engage, not our hybrid congregation, don't get confused with them, but those that watch regularly and receive regularly. I believe because you regularly receive, you know, the word says, if you've received, give. And I'd like to see people that tune in regularly, even though they're not a member of our hybrid church, because they've received the word, it would be nice for them to share in all good things. Because the Apostle Paul said this in Galatians, and I'm not going to read it, in Galatians 6:6-9, the Apostle Paul said, if you've received manna from a church, if you've received the word of the Lord, then you should in turn bless that ministry. Doesn't mean you always have to do it all the time. I'm talking to people that just watch online. But you have all these comments on a Wednesday night. You get 400 or 500 comments on a Wednesday night, and they're commenting. And it would be nice if once in a while somebody would just hit the button below and say, I'm going to give to the work of the Lord. Now, let me tell you something. Why? To meet the budget of Encounter Church? No. No. Although we have a budget, but no. Well, because in the covenant, Joe, there's what?
There's an equal exchange.
That's all. We're not charging for the gospel. We're not charging for the gospel. But I know this church does their part. I know that. I know this church does their part. But we've noticed this month, and I say we, I oversee, but there are those that actually do the hands-on work, like count the tithes and offerings that go into the mailbox. And for everyone watching online, we didn't receive hardly any mail in the month of January in the U.S. mail. So, hybrid church, if you gave in the mail, I don't think we received it. Is that safe to say, Joe?
No, the mail was much lower than it normally is for a month.
Say that again?
The mail, the amount of mail that we received in January was much lower than we normally receive.
Much lower.
Much lower than in a normal month.
Yeah. I mean, because... Yeah, so if you're part of our hybrid church and you gave, chances are we did not receive it. Chances are, in fact, there's a great chance we did not receive it. Now, if you're part of the hybrid church and you did not give, we trust your heart because I know you are a giver. We know you are givers, you know. But it's been an interesting month this month that on PayPal, very few have contributed on PayPal, those people that engage online who are not part of the church. But those who are part of our hybrid church, if you did send, we did not receive. So you may want to check your bank, if that be the count, or maybe you're part of hybrid and you were not able to give. God knows your heart. Maybe you lost your job or something. God knows your heart. We know your heart. We don't question you. But we believe that the body of Christ should do things corporately together. So now here we are in February. And listen, God supplies all of our needs. We're good. We're in good shape. Say we're in good shape. You know, there's one thing about Jim DePalma. I think you know how I feel when you look at me, okay? And I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth in love. We're in really good shape. Say really good shape.
Really good shape.
Yeah. But we're used to God supplying above and beyond. We're used to supplying. We're used to seeing God, who in this house is the God who's more than enough. Because I tell you one thing about us. We serve El Shaddai. And we're never going to say to you, El goodbye. I'll say it again. We serve El Shaddai more than enough, and we'll never be able to say to you, El goodbye. Hallelujah. Amen. I can guarantee you that. You can read my big, fat Italian lips. I can guarantee you that. Because God is faithful. And this is a resilient house. So now here it is in the month of February. It's the first Sunday. And we have a fresh start. Now, February is also a challenging month in the natural because there are only 4 Sundays and 4 Wednesdays, which means there are less opportunities to give, at least during service. But how many know God is not governed by days or weeks or months? He's not governed by that, nor are we. All of that being said, I want to see great fruit abound to our account. I want to see more in 24. More finances. And I'll tell you why I want to see more finances. I've been around long enough that I can say this, almost 50 years. I want this church to have more than enough, not so that this building has more than enough or I have more than enough, but honestly, as God is my witness, I put my hand on the Bible, as God is my witness, so that you and you will have more than enough. Father, today, we render to you first fruits. Father, I pray now on this. Mostly everyone has the revelation on tithing, if not all. On offerings, most, if not all, have the revelation. But Father, I pray that we all have the revelation of first fruits. In addition to tithing and offering, I pray, Lord, that we all, most do, but I pray for all. Lord, when they left Egypt, when they left the wilderness, there was not one feeble among them. I pray, God, in the same way that in this house there will not be one feeble among us. Not one sick among us is my prayer. But I pray, God, that each and every one of us will have the revelation of first fruits. Lord, how important it is, so important that a brother kills his brother over a first fruit. Oh, how the devil wants to withhold. And I pray, God, we are a church that each and every one of us together, everyone, renders first fruits. In addition to the tithe, and Lord, the offerings that we sow render the harvest. And Father, another revelation I'm asking to be increased, is what your Bible, your word calls oblations. Oblations, Lord, just because gifts. Lord, we can never outgive you. So today, Lord, on this first Sunday of the month, I thank you that we will have more than enough. More than enough to even make up for what was left as a deficit in the month of January, because you're more than enough. And Lord, I'll say this publicly, this is a healthy church. This is a healthy church. This is a God-fearing church. But Lord, we understand that January, the weather and different situations and circumstances and the U.S. mail, Lord, I thank you that you're more than enough. But Lord, I made you a promise. I made you a promise, Lord, I would never beg for money. Lord, I made you a promise I would never ask the people for money for me personally. I made you a promise, Lord, I'd put your house before my house. Because you said, Lord, if I put your house before my house, you'll take care of my house. And Lord, you've taken care of my house. Now, Lord, I pray that you take care of everyone's house. Father, I pray for increases. I pray for bonuses. I pray for unexpected checks in the mail. I pray for mail, period. Good mail, Lord. Not just bills, but unexpected checks, bonuses, increase, favor upon these dear people now in Jesus' name. And for our hybrid congregation as well. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Manta la boku santa la baka. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, Debbie, listen. Listen, Debbie. The Lord would say to you, you are faithful. Brother Josue, you are faithful. Prophetess Debbie, please relay this message to him. For I, the Lord, would say, did it catch me by surprise that your spiritual father would leave this earth and go to heaven? Did it catch me by surprise that your apostle, Dr. Gary Greenwald, would go to heaven now? No. But you see, my darling daughter, and yes, says the Lord, I call you darling, because that's who you are. You not only look darling on the outside, but you're more darling on the inside. And I say this ministry, Eagle's Nest, in Orange County, California, says the Lord, I will bring increase in various ways. Yes, there's been a paradigm shift, but I, says the Lord, have been in that shift. For I have used your spiritual father and apostle to raise up many and many. And even, says the Lord, his best-selling book, Subductions Exposed, has been used to save many a man and women for that matter, including Jim DePalma. So says the Lord, I say, welcome afresh your new beginning. Brother Josue and team, welcome your new beginning. For my son Gary is with me, and he's pleased with you and the ministry. For eye has not seen, nor has ear heard, nor entered the heart of man the things that I have prepared for those that love me. And the Lord says, Deborah. I just heard him say, Deborah. For you are Deborah. Deborah. You're a mother of the house, says the Lord. Great and mighty are you. Greatest strength and vision and anointing shall come upon you. Even tonight, says the Lord. Even as you prepare for tonight's service, right there in California, for you stand out in a state that has denied me, in a region that degrades me, yet the legacy of your spiritual father lives and lives, and it lives through you, darling Deborah. Josue and team, and God will always supply all of your needs and more than enough. This has been the word of the Lord. Somebody give God praise. Somebody give God praise. We love you, Prophetess Deborah. This is a spiritual daughter of Apostle Dr. Gary Greenwald, who went home to be with the Lord just weeks ago. that legacy lives and the ministry shall continue to the glory of God. Yup. It's taken a shift, like most churches, especially post-COVID, but God is still in it. God is still in. I prophesy again. I prophesy to somebody right now watching somewhere. I prophesy Micah, the prophet, Micah, chapter 7, verse 8. I prophesy the word of the Lord. Folks, I love when God's in control because there are no notes, just the leading of the Holy Spirit. That's why the word says be instant in and out of season. So I prophesy Micah, chapter 7, verse number 8. I prophesy Micah 7, verse 8. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I fall, I will arise. And here's the word. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light unto me. There are some of you watching right now, you're sitting in darkness. You're sitting in darkness. There are some of you in this room this morning, you may be feeling like you're sitting in darkness in the realm of the Spirit. To sit means that you've been there for a little while. You know how it is when your feet get tired, you need to sit. And the Lord says, when you sit in darkness, in other words, you're going through a season of darkness. The Lord says, remember this, that before I created the light, I created the darkness. And I'm equally in the darkness and as I am in the light. And the Lord says, though it may seem dark, it's really light. As you see what I see, you'll pierce through the darkness. For I am your light, and I am the light of this world. But remember this, my church, I've called you and you to be a light to this world. This is the word of the Lord. Lift your hands toward heaven if you would. Father, there's such a sweet anointing in this room. And I just want to, Lord, if I could, I'd like to call everyone in this room out by name and tell them how proud I am of them. If I could, Lord, I'd love to. I would love to, Lord, for our hybrid members, call each and everyone out by name, each and everyone, and tell them how proud I am of them. And now, Lord, unto him who's able to do far more, exceedingly and abundantly above all I could ask, think, or dare to imagine, be it unto these precious people now in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Somebody say more in 24. If you're writing a check, you can make it out to Encounter Church or checks. If you need an envelope, there's one underneath your seat. If you're using credit card, there's information there. If the Lord has spoken to you just now, even though your check's already been written a day ago or a week ago or this morning. But if the Lord would speak to you to say, hey, I want you to give an additional seat, if he would, even at home, you just obey the Lord. not me, the Lord. If you're using credit card, write the information as legibly as possible, please, so that the office does not have to call you and say, we're not sure about the numbers. If you want to call the church, just leave your name and number and somebody will get back to you. But if you're putting it in U.S. mail, you may want to put your hand over and pray over it and ask the Lord to commission his angels to make sure it arrives at 600 West Lake Street, Bartlett, Illinois, 60103. And you have an opportunity to give online as well. You can go down to the bottom of the screen to ourencounter.com. And you can give that way, and it's safe and secure. Lord bless you as you give. We love you with all of our hearts. And also, please do remember, sometimes I have to share this, we do not meet in the building on Wednesday night. And I want to tell you something. If we met in the building on Wednesday nights, I'm just telling you, more money would come in. But you see, I don't work for money. I work for the Lord. That's all I'll say on that. Lord bless you as you give. Love you so much. Amazing how God is using social media. I mean, here I am. It's 11:18, or just turned 19, 11:19 Central Standard Time. Thank you, guys. Central Standard Time. But it's 9:19 a.m. in California. And here I am sharing with you about tithes and offerings. How many think we're off to a good February already?
Yes.
And God just dropped a word in my spirit for Eagle's Nest in Southern California for a bishop, Dr. Pastor Gary Greenwald, that went home to be with the Lord, that has ministered in our church several times. And while we're here in Chicago, the power of social media, Jesus said, greater things shall you do. So we're excited about that, how we can, in the spirit, juggle all these things at the same time. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask you just one time, guys, because come on, let's get real. Are you ready for the word of the Lord?
Yes!
You know, it's been almost a year now. Talk about fresh encounters. Love you all so much. What was that? Did I hear something? What was that? Wait a minute. First of all, you said you love. First of all, is that what you said? You love me?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
Well, it's very obvious. But whoever said I love you more, we're going to debate that. That's fun. But almost a year ago, sweet people of God, I had a true fresh encounter with the grace of God. A true fresh encounter of the grace of God. And don't ask me why, but I compare it to a natural thing. You remember a few years back, the ice bucket challenge, right? I think they were raising money for, was it ALS? Yeah, which is Lou Gehrig's disease. Yeah. And I remember, you know, people were challenging people, and I was looking on Facebook. I'm saying, oh, Lord, please don't let them challenge me. And somebody did. Somebody did. I think it was Olivia. I'm going to get revenge with her. And I did it. I remember doing it in my first floor bathroom in the shower, you know, and I had to have my clothes on. And I think James David or somebody put that ice on me. It was like, let me ask you, how many did the ice bucket? Ice bucket? How many did the ice bucket challenge? Lift your hand high if you did the ice bucket challenge. Oh, half of you did the ice bucket challenge, right? Okay. Let me ask you this. You have to be honest now. You have to be honest. How many were asked to do the ice bucket challenge, but you didn't do it? Lift your hand. Okay. Just okay. There's always one in the crowd. Okay. Well, I remember doing that ice bucket challenge, and it was cold. But it was like invigorating. It was like a fresh touch came on me. It was not the exact touch that I was hoping for, but it was a fresh touch. Well, anyway, almost a year ago, as I said, I had a fresh encounter with the grace of God. And yes, it was very invigorating. And even though it's been almost a year, it has not stopped. It has not left me. It has not gone away. And every day, I'm experiencing His grace more and more. I know there are several reasons why. Spiritually and naturally. One of the reasons in the natural, and I'm not ashamed to say this because it's a fact of life. We're all getting older. How many know my Chelsea is getting older? You say, but she was just born on Monday. Yeah, but today is Sunday. She's almost a week old. She's getting older. Well, to us that are older, we're getting older. That makes sense, right? To us that are older, we're getting older. And as I'm getting older, I am finding that there are more things that I have to have more dependence on from other people to do. When I was real young, man, I used to love shoveling snow. I used to love it. And now it's, the shoveling part is not my best friend. And I thank God that I have people that assist in that area. I'm finding that as I'm getting older, because I used to be, and I say this with a humble heart, I do. I was a very good athlete, very good. I really wanted to play Major League Baseball. I was very good. How good was I? I was very good to the point where I had tryouts. I tried out with the New York Yankees. I tried out with the Kansas City Royals. I tried out with the Detroit Tigers. And then I went to Florida. 17, almost 18 years old, I went to Florida, to Hollywood, Florida, next to Fort Lauderdale, off of A1A. And I went for training with the Philadelphia Phillies. And when I got there, I mean, I knew I was good. But when I got there, I had a new revelation of what good was. Because when I got there, I realized as good as I was, there were players there that were even much better than I was. Much better. And some of them went on to play Major League Baseball. I knew had God called me to the ministry, but I was a little bit for just a little season, un poquito, just a little season. I didn't run away from God, my relationship. I ran away from the call, which is connected to God. So in some ways, I guess the relationship part, but not from the Lord himself, but from what he had called me to do. And I realized that the Lord wanted all of me to be used in the gospel ministry. But when I was young, I had so much strength. I'd work out faithfully every single day except Sunday. And I would lift weights. I would run. I was a sprinter. I was not a long-distance runner. I was a sprinter. I was one of the fastest runners in New York City. Where?
New York City.
Yeah, I really was. They timed me. They posted me. I was in newspapers. But my point is this. As I'm older, now, Pastor Joni says, my son JD says, Dad, you still have the hands. In other words, throw a ball at me. I still have the reflexes. I still can catch. I still got soft hands. I still got the reflexes. But there are many things. Here's my point. Not how good I am, but how much now more I have to depend on the Lord. Because there are things before that were easy for me to do. That because of age, frankly, come on, guys, because of wear and tear. I had to get my hip replaced. Why? The one I had was getting older and a lot of wear and tear. When you play football and you get tackled, and you get tackled several times a day, and your body lands on the hard grass, and sometimes concrete if you play in the streets, or if you play baseball and you're sliding in the third, or sliding in the second, you know, your body takes wear and tear. How many know what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? You know, 20 years ago, I did not wear eyeglasses. Where'd you go, by the way? Are you still here? Please, guys, somebody say, I'm still here.
I'm still here.
Ooh, thank goodness. Thank goodness. Oh, I had to sweat it out almost for a second. Oh, sorry. See? See, I need my glasses. Oh, there you are. There you are. I thought I lost the section. No, we just moved you over. But really, I depend on His grace even more. Because the less I'm dependent on my strength, the more I'm dependent on His. And there are some things in life that you have to realize. And this is a word for everybody, not just for the guy sitting in the back with the cap. This is a word for me. This is a word for Pastor Joni. This is a word even for The Rock, Mitch. Sometimes we may need, sometimes we may need some assistance. Does anybody need assistance?
Yes.
Sometimes we need a little assistance. There have been times I needed a walker. There have been times I needed a cane. Sometimes we need assistance. But my assistance has become in the grace of God. For what is grace? It's the ability of God to do in you and through you that which you cannot do on your own. I'm going to say that again. Because we've been taught through the years, grace is unmerited favor, grace is unmerited favor, and grace is unmerited favor. It is. But it's depending on God to do things that you just cannot do. It's depending on the Lord. Where you fall short, he comes in. And I'm just giving you just an illustration. Ladies, you know what I'm talking about. In your body, in your minds, even in our finances, individually and as a church, it's his grace that we depend upon. It's his ability. I can't force people to do anything. Ultimately, I have to depend on his grace in every aspect of my life. So I said all of that to say, what makes us resilient, because this is the word for the year. This is not the Iowa caucus where it's one and done. Who wins, who loses? Now on to New Hampshire, to South Carolina. No, no, no. This is about the kingdom giving us a word, God, not for a season, but for a reason. Not for one state so that we can move on to the next state to see how many delegates or votes we can get. But this is the word of the Lord that God has given me to tell Encounter Church, you're not going to be, you are a resilient people. You are a resilient people. There are times you may have to come in with a cane or a crutch. I'm not trying to speak that over you, but life is life. There are times that you may not feel the best. There are times you may not even look the best. But you are a resilient people. Sometimes your finances may fall a little short, but this is a church that still takes care of God's house. Now, I can't help but that there are some out there. They're everywhere. They're in your family. They're on your job. They're everywhere. I can't help but that there are some that are just spiritual freeloaders. But they're not my concern. I love everybody. But my concern is the one whom God's called me to be a captain over. To be an under-shepherd to the over-shepherd, that the over-shepherd leads this under-shepherd. And I say, as of the first month of this new year is already gone, now we start the second year, and before you know it, should the Lord tarry, we'll go through another year. You are a resilient people. Paul said, when you done all to stand, stand. This is a standing church. You are a standing people. Sometimes, come on, this happens to us all. We pray for one thing and it seems like it doesn't come to pass. And sometimes we question God, don't we? Sure we do. If you have a relationship with somebody, you'll ask questions. And sometimes it's easy to doubt God. But deep down in our hearts, we don't. Sometimes we feel like it, but deep down we don't. Because we know it's too late. God's already provided our needs. It's too late. He's already won. It's too late. He's already proved himself time and time and time again. So I just think it's interesting that the Lord gave me this word, another R word, on resilient and resilience and resiliency. And then, of course, again, and it bears repeating, it does bear repeating, that on New Year's Eve from New York City, as they're dropping the ball in New York, the secular commentators are saying that 2024 is going to be the year of resiliency. You got to see it on the screen for yourself. Yes? And then that very night I told you about Channel 9, WGN, celebrating their 75th anniversary, and Jack Brickhouse saying that Chicago is a resilient city and Chicagoans are resilient people. Yes? And then we showed you the article of the front cover of for January for Costco, and they speaks about cultivating resilience. Yes? Then I told you about a friend of mine who's becoming more and more of a dear friend of mine, pastors a great church in London, England, Majesty Champion Christian Center. And he said that Prophetess Cindy Jacobs was out there in England, in the United Kingdom, on the other side of the pond, and she went out there to preach to the UK that you're going to be resilient. Do you remember me sharing that with you? And then last Sunday I showed you pictures on the screen of now pastors having conferences in the U.S. and Canada and taking it now throughout different nations, having conferences on what? Resilience. Yes. So you know this is the word of the Lord. You know this is the word of the Lord. You know it is. You know it is. So if you would please, just for the next few minutes, because I really believe God's really in this house today. He always is. But not to be much, much longer, but put on the screen, if you would, 1 Corinthians 1:31. Now, some of these verses I've read to you before. Some you're hearing for the first time as far as coming from me in this message. But sometimes we need to hear something again and again. Somebody say again and again. Again. Somebody comment again and again. There we go. And that's 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 31. Put on the screen. Please, there we go. Thank you. That as it is written, that as it is written, he who glorifies, let him glorify in the Lord. Keep that right there, please. Thank you, guys. And thank you for doing such a great job. He who glorifies, let him glorify in the Lord. While you're keeping that verse right there, another translation says, he who boasts, let him boast in the Lord. Why do I share this verse? Because resilient people are people who know how to boast about the Lord. When something good happens, see that verse on the screen at home, at home, at home. Do you see that verse, hybrid? Do you see that verse on the screen? Do you? Do you? Resilient people know that when something good takes place in their life, that they know that they're not to receive the praise, honor, and glory, but God and God alone. If you believe it, give God a shout of praise. Resilient people know that God gets the glory. Resilient people know that God gets the honor. Resilient people know, like what Paul the Apostle said in 1 Corinthians, please, on the screen, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 9. Resilient people know this, but the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 9, look at this, guys. I shared this earlier. For I am the least. Somebody shout least. Least. Folks, I said something Wednesday night. I said something Wednesday night. I said something Wednesday night. That human nature, all of us by nature. So I'm not calling you this, I'm calling your nature this. You understand the difference? I'm not labeling you, you're this. I'm saying your nature is. But all of us have a selfish nature. And everyone shouted, amen.
Amen.
In fact, you came out of your mother's womb. Or in some of you, if you had a C-section, their belly. We came out selfish. We came out crying. Why did we come out crying? Because I want, I want, I want. I need, I need, I need. I've got to have, and I got to have. Well, guess what? Some 60 years after birth, even some 70 years after birth, are still saying, I need, I need, I need. I want, I want, I want. I got to have, I got to have, I've got to have. Now, they're not saying, well, I'm just claiming my healing in Jesus' name. That's different. We, by nature, are selfish. By nature, we are selfish. And one of the things that makes us resilient people is by saying, I'm not going to be selfish. I'm going to go forward. I don't care what anybody says about me. I don't care what people do. I'm not going to be selfish. Although I feel like being selfish, I refuse to be selfish. So Paul says, for I am the least of all the apostles. In other words, he was guarding against selfishness. What was he guarding against?
Selfishness.
He knew who he was. Come on, give me a break. He knew that he was one of the mightiest apostles who ever lived. St. Paul, that is. He knew it. But he also knew, I'm not going to trust my flesh. I'm not going to, look at me, guys. Oh, Jimmy. Jimmy boy. I don't trust my flesh. I don't trust your flesh. We don't trust any flesh. That's why we are to live in the Spirit, by the Spirit. They that worship him. Doesn't say they that worship him must worship him in flesh. No, flesh needs to be crucified. Somebody said to me, Pastor, would you pray for me? I said, sure, what is it? They said, would you please help me? I keep going through the same thing, and the same thing keeps happening and happening. Doesn't God hear my prayers? I said, well, it depends on what you're praying. Because James says you ask and you ask amiss. I said, what are you praying for? And this person said, I'm praying that I'm able to control my flesh. I said, that's why you're in the position you're in. Because you're trying to control your flesh. Your flesh was not made to be controlled. Your flesh was made to be
crucified.
I didn't even ask you, and you guys said it. So now I'll say it real loud. Your flesh was made to be
crucified.
I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ who lives in me. Not in my notes, but I like to speak sometimes just whatever comes out of my spirit. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ who lives in me. And the rest of that verse says, and the life that I live in the flesh, because the flesh is always there, and the life that I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of the living God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Would you like the address? Would you like the address? Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ. Here, I am the least of the apostles. I'm not even worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church. Resilient people always remember where they came from. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. I'll say it again. Resilient people always remember where they came from. You see some of these celebrities, superstars, singers, actors, whoever they are. Today they're very popular, in demand. Some of them are even worshipped more than Jesus. I can name names, but they're not even worthy to be named. They get enough news coverage and media coverage and football coverage. But there's one name given unto man, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. At the name of Jesus every tongue shall confess. And Paul realized sometimes, he said, I'm not going to live in my past, but I'm going to remember. I'm going to remember what the Lord has done. I'm going to remember what the Lord has done. And I trust that some of our big movie star celebrities, sports celebrities, remember where they came from. That it was the Lord who saved them. That it was the Lord who raised them up. Are you hearing me? And we, the church, need to remind ourselves of where we came from. Doesn't say go back. In fact, it says go forward. Press on. But sometimes we need to remind ourselves. I'm telling you, folks, there are times I just sit in my room and I think about what the Lord has done for me. I think about where I came from. I think about how I was told, how I was told by my abomination, I mean my denomination, I'm sorry. I remember the demon board, I'm sorry, the deacon board. I'm getting a little tongue-tied this morning, I'm sorry. And for the record, I love my denomination and I love deacons. But I remember the time they said, son, you'll never preach again. My attitude was not, how can you say that? I'm going to prove you wrong. I said, okay. I remember the time I was not allowed to preach in another church. I remember times where I would not get an invitation to go somewhere. I remember a time when I was treated like I had a plague or leprosy. And now I see what the Lord has done. And sometimes I look back. But when I look back, I don't say, you were wrong. How many know that's arrogance? That's pride. Let me tell you something about resilient people. I'm talking about you. Can I still brag about you? I know we're into another month. Can I still brag on you? Do you like to brag about your kids? I didn't get too many yeses on that one. Some of you have kids here right now in the room, so they need to hear it. Do you like to brag about your kids?
Yes.
Even if you got to fake it, say it again. Yes.
Yes.
You're not faking it. You're not faking it. But resilient people, remember where they came from. Because resilient people know where they're going. Because resilient people know where they're at. Where they're at. And that's what Paul was saying. I'm the least. I am the least. And he was not going back into his past saying, oh, God, I really blew it, although he does regret what he did. But look at the next verse. Look what the next verse says. But that by the grace of God. Do you see that, guys?
Yes.
At home, do you see that at home? But by the grace of God, I am what I am. By the grace of God, I am what I am. Resilient people know that they are what they are by the grace of God. By the grace of God, I am what I am. Look at this. And His grace. Somebody say His grace. Let me tell you something. I feel compelled to say this. Sometimes people have not been gracious to you. And let's be very blunt. Sometimes you have not been gracious to other people. We, all of us. But His grace, say His grace. Which means when people don't show you grace, there's still His grace. And you can always count on His grace. You can always depend on His grace. But His grace, look at this, toward me. Would you put your name in there? See where it says toward me? Would you put your name in there? Put your name in there. I heard somebody say Gloria. But His grace toward Gloria. Any other names in this house? Sally. But His grace toward Sally. Did I hear any else name? But His grace toward Patty. His grace toward Joey. Did anybody else mention their name today? But His grace toward Mauricio. Did I hear anybody else's name? Me? Steve. But His grace toward Steve. Does anybody else have a name in this house today? But His grace toward Ida. Anybody else have a name in this house? Let me ask you a question. When you were born, when you were born, did you get a name? Okay. Put your name in there. Who else's name? Eileen. But His grace toward Eileen. But His grace toward Mitch. But His grace toward Sierra. His grace toward Joni. His grace toward Donna. His grace toward Audia. Say your name. His grace toward Dawn. His grace toward Mark. On account, His grace toward Nidia. On the count of three, everybody shout your name. One, two, three. There it is. There it is. There it is. This is for you. At home, this is for you. This is for you. Shout your name one more time on three. One, two, three. One, two, three. Now say it backwards. No, really, one more time. One, two, three. You know, when you just said that name, you understand that name that you just said is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life? Do you realize what I just said? That name that you just said is written forever. And let me tell you something. Somebody get ready to scream. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Okay? You just said that name. But let me tell you something about God, the way He writes. Get ready to scream. Number one, He does not write with a pencil. And number two, there's no eraser attached to it. Shout! Your name is written, and there's no eraser. Which means you're His. You're His. And He is yours. I am my beloved. And my beloved is mine. And His banner over me is love. And love never fails. Because God never fails. We are a resilient church. You are resilient people. Oh, and if I had time, I'd give you much, much more. I'm not even going to tell you don't even put it on the screen, and we're not compromising because you're getting it. But I love what Peter said. Don't even put it on the screen, please. Thank you, guys, and you're doing so awesome. But Peter said in 2 Peter 3:18, he says, grow in grace, which means as we grow in grace, we grow in being resilient. As we grow in grace, we grow in being resilient. As we grow in grace. James 4:6 says, Well, James says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Resilient people walk in humility. Resilient people are not interested in letting their selfishness have its way, but the Lord having his way. Oh my, there's so much more. Resilient people, Hebrews 4:16, come boldly to the throne of grace. Resilient people come boldly through the throne of grace. Resilient people know that they have a Father who loves them, a Father that cares for them. And the interesting thing about us, sometimes we feel so unworthy. I'm not a good father. I'm not a good mother. I'm not good at this. I'm not good at that. And guess what? You're right. You're not. Huh? But you are, by the grace of God. You are, by the grace of God. Guys, honestly, I've got, you know, listen, I'm still old school. I still go by the book. I was watching yesterday Dennis's dad's class, and he had a gentleman who's 77 minister yesterday, and today for that matter, at his church. And Dennis's church, they meet on Sunday morning, Wednesday night, Thursday night prayer, Saturday morning, son's class, father's class. Well, yesterday they had a gentleman speak at his church at the son and daughter's class. And he said, I'm 77 years old. That's interesting. Now that I'm almost 67, there was a time in my life where if I would have heard somebody say that they're 77, I would look and said, wow, they're old. But now, at 67 almost, I say, wow, he's still pretty young. So he said, you know, it's a true story. You can go on Dennis's Open Wells. You can go to Dennis Davis, Goldsworthy Davis. You can go to Open Wells. You'll see 77 years old, had white hair. And he says, I still use up my old notebook when I preach. So don't anybody judge me thinking that I'm not giving a fresh word from the Lord just because I don't use a tablet, just because I don't use a computer. He said, let me tell you something about my notebook. The battery doesn't run low. He said, let me tell you something about my notebook. I don't have to recharge it. He said, let me tell you something about my notebook. He said, when some of you guys...